I've seen a lot of people online recently basically claiming that they're too pretty. And whilst there's a current trend on TikTok of people admitting that they have something called pretty privilege, an offshoot of that trend is people saying that maybe they are too pretty. It kind of ruins their life. I've been wanting to do this video on pretty privilege for a really, really long time. But just a warning, this script ended up being just a jumble of thoughts and kind of my thought process about pretty privilege and how that is relevant to the society we live in today. I don't think we're really gonna come to many conclusions, but I want to keep it like an open conversation and dialogue, so please chat away in the comments. The more research I did on pretty privilege, the more I started to realize that it is in fact a science, and a lot of what I'm talking about today isn't actually my own opinion, it's just science fact. I will be talking about my own opinion towards the end of the video. As I mentioned, conventionally attractive people are sharing their experiences with pretty privilege over on TikTok, and some of the stories are pretty wild, to be honest with you, and some of the things that these conventionally attractive people get away with just because they look pretty is kind of crazy.
Pretty privilege in Miami is actually insane. Not only can girls get into clubs for free, but there are a handful of apps that give models and influencers free food, drinks, anything. So this one is called Beauty Pass. It gives you free coffee, lunch, etc. just for posting a story and tagging the business. Each app, you have a little profile so that the company can see that it's actually you. The third app I have is a little different. This one's called OTH, meaning on the house. This one I went and interviewed for a few months ago. They give you an actual card. Each influencer gets a weekly balance to spend at these businesses in exchange for two stories, one picture and one video. Users get to spend their weekly allowance on their card at places like bars, restaurants, beauty salons. There's also gyms, yoga studios, soon to be hotels and flights. It's crazy.
And under these videos, you see two types of feedback. One being like, oh my God, thanks for being so honest about how much easier life is for you as a pretty person, as a conventionally attractive person. Or the other one being people like, oh my God, you're not that pretty, you're ugly, get over yourself. Pretty privilege doesn't mean that you have to be beautifully stunning, like breathtakingly gorgeous in order to have pretty privilege. You just have to have what is considered a conventionally attractive face. Not even that, your face just has to hit a certain criteria that our brain just so happens to like. But first of all, let's try and describe, explain, define pretty privilege. Pretty privilege is the idea that people who are deemed more conventionally attractive, based on deep-rooted beauty standards, have more of an upper hand in life, given more opportunities, social advantages, and in general, just have it much easier than those who may be deemed to be average or ugly. And this is what's known as the halo effect. The most recent study on pretty privilege, and there are studies, there are a lot of studies. This is a subject that scientists actually seem to be really, really interested in. This study took a deeper look into why we as humans automatically connect conventionally attractive people with goodness. And it found that conventionally attractive people were deemed to have more good moral traits than those who were deemed unattractive. Like that's something people just presumed because they thought somebody looked good. And not just good moral traits, but humans on average tend to automatically presume that more attractive people are smarter, they're more creative, more financially stable, more socially aware, and more hygienic than those deemed average. And this is what we call the halo effect. A person who is perceived good in one area automatically is presumed good in all other areas of life. And of course, physical appearance is the first thing we see. It's our first impression, and sometimes only impression, of another human being. And these studies showed that if a person is deemed attractive, then our first impression is overwhelmingly good, with people even often feeling safer around strangers who were attractive. And as I mentioned, one thing I learned about pretty privilege doing this research is that whether we like it or not, there is a science behind what humans will automatically find attractive that goes beyond what society has told us and what the forever changing beauty standards throughout history has told us should be attractive too. There is a default that is separate from how our own personal tastes will change as well as we like navigate the world ourselves. To cut a long story short, because it was very complicated, the human brain likes to look at nice symmetrical things. I think we all kind of know that, the whole symmetry, like Cleopatra's mask kind of theory. Lines and shapes that are put together in a certain way that are easy to digest visually, certain types of configurations and forms is all it really comes down to. We see that in art, we see in architecture, we see it in cute animals, in the human face and in the body. Neuroscience and Jan Chatterjee explains that when it comes to the brain, there are a few main factors that determine human attractiveness. And two that I found the most interesting were, unsurprisingly, symmetry and something called averaging? Averaging is quite difficult to explain, so I will be looking at my notes. And when we say average, we aren't talking about an average looking person. We are talking about the average in a mathematical term. The average look that best represents a group of people in this case. And overwhelmingly, the features that humans find attractive is mixed features. Features that represent multiple populations, feature greater genetic diversity, because from an evolution standpoint, this kind of represents a better adaptation to their environments. With many people finding multiracial people more attractive, think tall, dark, and handsome. I think the best modern day example of this that I could find is faceresearch.org's face study that got pictures of people from every country and composited them to show what the average person from each country looked like. And this mix, these averages of the faces, made for some very attractive people. Now, of course, symmetry is the one we all know about, right? It's the one we're constantly taught. Everything has to be symmetrical for it to look nice. It's the reason cosmetic surgery is so popular. Surgery, the outcome is always about symmetry, balancing out things. And this is because our human brain automatically connects asymmetry with developmental abnormalities, while symmetry is connected to health and goodness. And while symmetry is something that is constantly linked to beauty, it wasn't until the 1930s that inventor Maximilian Fachtowicz introduced it to the world of cosmetics with his invention of the beauty micrometer. This was like a giant birdcage claw type thing that would be put over a subject's face. Back in those days, it was purely women. And this would help identifying any kind of abnormalities in the person's face. Areas of the face that would need their appearance enhanced or even reduced. So say you had like a lopsided nose, it would measure that little lopsidedness and tell you where you need to, like, you know, contour basically, I guess. This device would measure subject's face with 325 adjustments, enabling the operator to make super fine measurements to within a thousandth of an inch. This machine would measure the heights of the nose and the forehead, which Fachtowicz says should be the same. So your nose should... I think I'm cheating. That should be the same. Whilst the eye should be separated by one eye width apart. So like that could go there. So mine are a bit too close. With the idea that when an imperfection is identified, makeup could be used to correct that area. He would then use these findings to sell his own subjects, his own makeup brand, Max Factor, to help fix these flaws. So let's talk about the brain and go back to our neuroscience friend, Anjan Chatterjee. I'm gonna have to read this. He says, beautiful faces activate a part of our visual cortex in the back of the brain that we use to recognize faces and an adjacent part of the brain called the lateral optical complex that processes objects. Attractive faces in particular activates part of our brain's reward and pleasure centers in the front and deeper parts of the brain. These all come together and create the idea of beauty. And this is something that our brain does all the time, unconsciously. You're in a queue somewhere, there's a pretty person over there, you look at them, you don't really think much about it, but in your head like, oh my god, they're stunning, you know? So we really can't deny that to recognize beauty is just built into our human brains. More so, to recognize symmetry. And to me, that's good enough to secure the fact that pretty privilege exists. But as I mentioned, there were a surprising amount of studies actually done on pretty privilege, or attractiveness privilege as it's more professionally known. So let's run a few, I guess, facts and figures or results of studies. One study showed that employers viewing photographs of potential employees were inclined to increase salaries by nearly 10.5% to attractive people in order to convince them to take the job. According to the Mobius and Rosenbolt study on pretty privilege in 2006, physically attractive individuals are perceived as more sociable, dominant, sexually warm, mentally healthy, intelligent, and socially skilled. Attractive people often benefit from this bias from an early age, resulting in greater confidence as a result and going into adulthood. Researchers suggest that confidence translates into success, as self-assured individuals are more likely to step out of their comfort zones. A study was conducted to test whether or not physical attractiveness plays a role in unobserved productivity by comparing attractiveness to grades in college courses. This is the Hernandez and Peters study from 2017. Variables were manipulated through two groups, groups of students whose appearances were directly observed by instructors and groups of students whose appearances were not. The study found that appearances did indeed matter, as attractive female students earned a higher grade than unattractive ones. One study of MBA graduates found that there was about a 10 10 to 15% difference in earnings between the most and least attractive people in the group. I don't know how they decided that one, which added up to about $230,000 over a lifetime. I think one of the better examples of pretty privilege in pop culture is Jeremy Meeks. Meeks was arrested on a felony weapons charge. His whole gang was arrested. The gang's mugshot, including Meeks' mugshot, was posted on the Stockton Police Department's Facebook page. And only after 24 hours of posting Meeks' mugshot, it got like 15,000 likes and over 3,700 comments, purely commenting on how attractive he was. Nothing to do with the charges, nothing about his felony. He was then sentenced to 27 months in prison. He served only 13. And then upon release, he was immediately signed with White Cross Management, and he now has a thriving modeling and acting career, which, don't get me wrong, I think is great. He's turned his life around. It saved him from a life of crime. But the point is, when he was a felon, when he just got arrested, nobody cared. Nobody cared because he was beyond conventionally attractive. This guy was model attractive. Now, of course, there will be nuances on this, on what attractive is. There'll be differences all around the world that are rooted in history and cultural differences, but the key aspects of what our human brain defines as beautiful or pretty pretty much remains the same. But there are more nuances than just these cultural differences that I don't feel a lot of people talk about. Anjan Chatterjee brought up a really interesting point in his TED talk, where he showed how movie villains are often depicted as having a deformity, which is usually like, you know, a big scar going down their eyes, really playing on the fact that our brain sees asymmetry as less than, as a negative, and as something that's not safe to be around. But this got me thinking, because I love a villain. Gays love a woman villain, an evil queen. So why do male villains look like this, but female villains look like this? Evil queens are always visually stunning. Pretty girls are always the mean girls in high school. Why are attractive, successful women always the annoying bad character in rom-coms? I mean, even Mystique is symmetrically attractive. She's meant to be a mutant. Of course, you have your exceptions, right? But the majority of the time, women villains are attractive. And this got me thinking about the idea of, maybe for women in particular, pretty privilege can go beyond a privilege. It was really hard to find a clear-cut answer to this. I thought there'd be more studies about it. But what I did find is a lot more about film theory. And it kind of comes down to the point of the age-old stereotype that women should be at home having kids in the kitchen. So when you see an attractive, powerful, successful woman in some way, it's somehow seen as breaking the rules. It's somehow seen as a threat. Whilst attractive, powerful men are seen as heroes, attractive, powerful women are seen as weaponizing their sexuality. And there's almost this mistrust of powerful, attractive, confident women in society that, deep-rooted, people are like, something's not right here, something's not right here. In an article called The Problem with Blockbuster Female Villains and the Perception of Femininity, Mia Garfield explains, a woman who owns her sexuality is bad or is punishing for pursuing pleasure. We cannot have a strong woman who reflects the complexity of women in reality. She cannot be strong in the male fashion. She must be strong and successful because she uses her feminine wiles. Now, this is also kind of noticeable in any kind of mean girl character in any kind of like high school film, drama, whatever. Here they aren't using their sexuality at such a young age, but more so attractiveness as social currency. Especially at an age where you're going through puberty and all that really matters to you at the time is fitting in, your looks matter more, and really attractiveness plays a key role in that at such a young age. But this is where we do see the halo effect really coming into play. A movie example of this is obviously Regina George from Mean Girls, the original. She is conventionally more attractive, and because of this she is extremely popular. She has developed advanced social skills and confidence, and excels in school despite not really being that smart, appearing not to be that smart. Again, an example where a female lead is being portrayed as using her looks for power, for evil, basically. But there have been times throughout history, where attractive women have been referred to as evil. Hesiod, I believe his name is pronounced, is an 8th and 7th century BC author whose works are referred to as close to the Bible as you can get back in those days. Described the first created woman simply as Kalon Kakon, the beautiful evil thing. She was evil because she was beautiful. She was beautiful because she was evil. They were both directly linked. A BBC article says that being a good-looking man was fundamentally good news. Being a handsome woman, by definition, spelt trouble. In Bram Stoker's Dracula, all the female vampires use their beauty and sexuality to control men. And you may notice that, unsurprisingly here, I'm talking about women. And as I mentioned, that's because when it comes to being attractive, when it comes to pretty privilege, men are overall seen to be powerful leaders, whereas women, on the other hand, are seen to be a powerful threat. That leads us onto the thought that can being too attractive really have a negative side effect? And there was an interview on This Morning of a woman who was like, I can't get a job because I'm too attractive, everyone hates me.
The crime that I've committed is that I dare to say that I'm beautiful, that I'm attractive, and that other women don't like me for it.
And nowhere more bitchy than at the work front, says Samantha.
Women bosses have been the bane of my life. They will keep you down if they see you as a threat. I don't know if you're familiar with the phrase in Australia, the Queen Bee Syndrome.
Yes, very much.
Every office, every group of women, there's always the Queen Bee.
Oh, good morning, Miranda.
Get me Isaac.
And if another woman comes into that situation and looks as good at her or better, it causes untold amounts of problems.
And people were kind of laughing at her and being like, oh, you know, the usual put downs, you're ugly, you're not that attractive, blah, 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 blah. But we've seen examples here that there's kind of like this stereotype now, a more modern day stereotype that goes beyond what our brain naturally thinks. When we see somebody who is attractive, they could be evil, they could be a threat. Now, despite the halo effect being a well-known trope, I guess you can say, amongst neuroscientists, a more recent study by social psychologists Lisa Slattery-Walker and Tonya Frevert from the University of North Carolina and Charlotte may suggest that the halo effect may not be as powerful as we all once thought. Sexist prejudice have been shown to take place, especially when it comes to the workplace. According to the study, people of the same sex are less likely to hire someone who they feel is more attractive than them. But we also have the dumb blonde stereotype as well that can come into play, where they don't necessarily see them as a threat, but employers believe that because somebody looks a certain way, maybe they are the stereotypical blonde, attractive, or dumb jock, they automatically presume that they are not well equipped enough for the job. They aren't smart enough for the job, or they don't have enough experience purely because they fit a certain stereotype. Back in 2018, the London Business School and University of Maryland came together and carried out 4 office experiments in the US and the UK. Those participating in the office study were basically given CVs, and they had to hire a candidate for this job role. A very typical everyday situation. What the participants weren't told was that nearly all these CVs were pretty much exactly the same. They had pretty much all the same qualifications. Everything was just worded a little bit different. In fact, everybody was suitable for the job. The only difference was the photos attached to the CVs, some more conventionally attractive, others more average looking. The male participants actually completely overlooked any attractive male CVs, judging purely on their photograph that they actually lacked skill. Not only that, but other participants who took part in this study admitted that they wouldn't dream of hiring somebody that attractive because they felt that they deserved a better job than the one they were hiring for, purely based on their good looks. I find that so weird. That's so weird. So because someone was more attractive, they believed they weren't suited to the job because they believed they deserved more and should aim for more. With that all in mind, I would argue that one of the more prevalent stereotypes nowadays when it comes to conventionally attractive people is that pretty people are stupid. And this idea does come from the halo effect as well. So whilst the halo effect is very much the fact that people think, oh, you know, they're attractive, so they must excel in other areas, I guess a more modern version of the halo effect is, oh, they're attractive, so they floated through life without really having to learn anything or put any effort into anything or work for anything. Therefore, they've not learned as much as your average looking person. A study conducted by psychologists at the University of Essex and the University of Cambridge found evidence of a bias against attractive people. In their study titled Facial Appearance Affects Science Communication, they found that scientists who were perceived as conventionally more attractive are less likely to be seen as good scientists who conduct good, solid, accurate research, purely because they look attractive. So then we have this other stereotype that clever people look a certain way. I guess your stereotypical geeky person, right? Attractiveness nowadays doesn't seem to be tied to wisdom in any way whatsoever. Now, does this all mean that pretty privilege does not exist? No, it 100% exists. And I think forever will exist as long as human brains work the way they do. I feel like it's something that we almost have to unlearn as we get older. However, the halo effect is still very real and more prevalent than any bias against attractive people. And I feel like these examples that we have of people being too attractive that it negatively affects their lives are very few and far between, and probably not the reality for most conventionally attractive people's lives. My personal thoughts on this, I do generally think as as we get older, we still know what conventionally attractive things are supposed to look like. From my experience and those around me too, that becomes less important to us. I feel like we forget all these social constructs and we form our own opinions really based on our own ideal types, depending on how and where we've grown up, you know, the different roads that we've gone down. It's so funny because some people love like a Calvin Klein model. Some people love people who are covered in tattoos. And you know, everyone's talking about how attractive Ryan Gosling is. And I'm like, what about Seth Rogen? Like, I think he's really attractive. I do feel like the more people you meet, the more cultures you experience, the more you venture into the world in general, the more we develop our own ideas of what's attractive. And I hate saying this because it always sounds like a magnet or an inspirational quote, but I feel like, tell me your opinion as well. I feel like as you get older, attractiveness becomes more than physical appearance. I think anyway, like we said, someone's physical appearance is that first opinion. We've all met attractive people who are absolute dickheads, right? And I think as you get older, as you realize what's truly important in life, you tend to just break out of those stereotypes. Like, is a goth gonna find a conventionally attractive, sporty jock type attractive? No, I don't think so. But I do think pretty privilege exists, unfortunately, where it's gonna affect us and our brain the most. And that is in our teenage years. There's a YouTube video from Allure. It's called Girls Aged 5 to 18 Talk About What Beauty Means to Them. And during this video, you see the ages from like 5 to 12 talking about how beauty is in the world around them, animals are beautiful, their mum's beautiful, beauty's within, all things that you can tell their parents are teaching them. You know, they're trying to install good morals into their children.
Beauty is something that people like that is beautiful. Bows are beautiful. Dolphins are beautiful. My mom's beautiful. My heart is beautiful. I find my whole body beautiful. There's my mom and dad's DNA in my body, and it makes each part of me special.
Then the moment these teenagers hit 12, 13 upwards, you hear them talking about conventional beauty standards and how it's affecting them, but also an understanding that that's not the way life is supposed to be.
My school is a predominantly white school. There was like very much a one shot like picture of beauty. And so I straightened my hair probably like every other week or so. I started watching a lot of YouTube videos of other natural girls, just seeing like those other people embracing their hair and really like loving themselves for who they were really inspired me by wearing my hair natural. I've really embraced who I am.
Which wasn't a thing when I was a teenager. We had Paris Hilton, heroin chic. We had makeover shows and America's Next Top Model, really emphasizing what our brain thinks is naturally tells us is attractive, but taking it to the extreme. We didn't have all the amazing body positivity, all the self-instilled confidence that like teenagers, what looks like they have nowadays, which is great. So as I do think pretty privilege will always be a thing, I think being pretty will become average. The default, almost boring, the more generations are taught to see beyond the very basics of what we are told is conventionally attractive. Let me know what you think in the comments down below. As I mentioned, this was just kind of like a jumble of my thoughts. I feel like I've not really come to any conclusion, but I feel like there's so many routes you can go down here. Gender stereotypes, sexualization, sexism. I don't think I'm qualified to talk about any of them, to be honest with you. But let me know what you think in the comments down below. You can watch some more When Beauty Turns Ugly here. So in general, light entertainment here, and I'll see you over there.